Part 4, Chapter 2, The Istari. Wizard is a translation of Quenya Istar, one of the members of an order, as they called it, claiming to possess and exhibiting eminent knowledge of the history and nature of the world. They belonged solely to the Third Age, and then departed, and none save maybe Elrond, Círdan, and Galadriel discovered of what kind they were or whence they came. The wizards, in fact, arrive in Middle-earth in Third Age 1000 as emissaries from the Lords of the West, the Valar. But why? Well, because the Valar see that Sauron is gaining power and influence. This is around the time that the first shadow falls on Mirkwood. So, with the permission of Eru, they send fellow Ainur to Middle-earth to do good works among men and elves, and advise and persuade them to also do good and resist Sauron's power. However, this time around, these Ainur are neither allowed to reveal their true majesty and glory, nor to rule over people by force. Instead, they come in the bodies of humble old men. They don't actually die or appear to grow any older, although they are still subject to the weariness and weaknesses of physical bodies, like pain, fear, thirst, and hunger. Their bodies can be slain, but because they are immortal spirits, they don't actually die. We don't actually know how many wizards come to Middle-earth, but of the ones who come to the north, the chiefs are 5, and they all come at different times. The first to arrive is noble-looking, fair in voice, and clad in all white. He's considered the head of the order. The next two are clad in sea-blue robes, and the fourth in earthen brown. And the last one doesn't look so grand or mighty, and he seems older than the others. Perhaps that's because his hair and robes are gray, and he always leans on a staff. The first person to come across these wizards when they arrive in the Grey Havens is Círdan, and he can sense that this Grey One is actually the greatest and wisest of them all. So he gives this Grey One the red ring Narya, telling him that it will ease his labors and help him to kindle all hearts to courage. So the Grey Messenger takes it in secret. But sooner or later, the White Messenger discovers the gift, and from then on he starts to begrudge the Grey Messenger and feel ill will towards him. This White Wizard becomes known among the elves as Curunir, the Man of Craft, and among men he is called Saruman. Not much is known of the Blue Wizards, who in this part of the chapter are just collectively called Ithrinluin, the Blue Wizards. They go into the East and never come back. We don't know 100% what they do there, but in one of Tolkien's letters, as noted at the end of this chapter, he says, "I fear that they failed, as Saruman did, though doubtless in different ways, and I suspect they were founders or beginners of secret cults and magic traditions that outlasted the fall of Sauron." So, yeah. Now, keep in mind, the wizards are clad in human flesh, and because of that, they kind of have to slowly relearn things through experience. They do know where they come from, but it's not like the Undying Lands are fresh in their brains. The memory of that place is kind of like the memory of a dream. So, because of their weak physical bodies and this very distant, unclear memory of Aman, they are more vulnerable to corruption and falling away from their mission. So that's why Saruman and the Blue Wizards are capable of losing the plot, so to speak. They are not infallible. Even Radagast, who doesn't go bad per se, loses focus and gets distracted by his love of birds and beasts, rather than completing the task to move the hearts of elves and men against Sauron. Only the Grey One remains uncorrupted throughout. The elves call him Mithrandir, the Grey Pilgrim, because he doesn't take up a permanent residence anywhere. He's always on the move, helping people out and giving them courage and hope. Among men, he's known as Gandalf, or the Elf of the Wand, because he can always be seen leaning on his staff. So this is the basic background of the origins of the Istari. But according to this chapter, the other writings about them are pretty short and hastily written. But here's an interesting sketch of a narrative that shows a meeting of the Valar when they decide on sending the wizards to Middle-earth. Manwë gathers the Valar, and they decide to send 3 emissaries to Middle-earth, and the conversation states that they must be peers of Sauron. mighty in their own right, but foregoing might when they come to Middle-earth. They have to inhabit human bodies in order to interact with elves and men on an equal footing, and thus they will be subject to fears, weariness, and a dimming of wisdom. But only two come forward to volunteer in this task, the first being Kurumo, sent by Aule. Kurumo is Saruman, and Alatar, sent by Orome. Alatar is one of the Blue Wizards. Then Manwë says, "Hey, what about Olorin? Why don't you go too?" Olorin is Gandalf. But Olorin says that he is too weak for such a task and that he fears Sauron, and Manwë replies, "Ah, all the more reason for you to go." When all is said and done, five wizards wind up going, because Yavanna asks Kurumo to bring along her servant Eowyndil, and that's Radagast the Brown. And Alatar brings his friend Pallando, the other blue wizard. A later essay goes on to state that we must assume the Istari are all Maiar, just like Sauron is a Maia. They are sent out at a crucial moment in the history of Middle-earth to enhance the resistance of the elves of the West, waning in power, and of the uncorrupted men of the West, greatly outnumbered by those of the East and South. They were not commanded or supposed to act together as a small central body of power and wisdom. Each had different powers and inclinations, and were chosen by the Valar with this in mind. Gandalf proves to be the director and coordinator both of attack and defense in the fight against Sauron. The chapter indicates that many of the faithful believe Gandalf to actually be the last appearance of Manwë himself. But this probably isn't true. The next time Manwë comes down from Taniquetil will be for the last great battle, the Dagor Dagorath, when Melkor returns at the end of days. After all, Manwë only sends his herald Eowyndil to defeat Morgoth in the War of Wrath. I mean, that was a big battle. So to defeat Sauron, of course he's going to send a lesser angelic being, thus the wizards. Now let's look at some etymology, shall we? The name Olorin is a Quenya name, which means it must have been given to him by the elves of Valinor. Olor means dream, not sleep, but rather as in the vivid contents of elvish memory, or imagination of clear vision in the mind, of things not immediately physically present. For example, an earlier version of the name of Lorien is Olofantur, master of visions and dreams. Olorin dwells in the gardens of Lorien, actually, and he walks unseen among the elves, putting into their hearts fair visions and promptings of wisdom, of things that could be made in the future for the betterment of Arda. Gandalf talks about his various names in Middle-earth. Mithrandir among the elves, Tharkun to the dwarves. Olorin I was in my youth in the west that is forgotten, in the south Incanus, in the north Gandalf. To the east I go not. In the earlier days of Gandalf's work in Middle-earth, he maybe goes to Harad, to the south of Gondor. Sauron is very active in this area during the Third Age, and perhaps there are still men here who are able to be turned towards resistance against him. According to one note in the chapter, the name Incanus is based on a name in the Haradrim language meaning North Spy. But in a different note, there is some doubt as to whether Gandalf actually goes to Harad, or just to an area that is a part of Gondor at one point in history. In that case, Incanus must be a Quenya word devised in Gondor early on when Quenya is still used by the learned. So if Incanus is Quenya, then In means mind, and Can means ruler. However, we know that Gandalf's primary territory is in the northwest. His main alliance is with Elrond and the northern Dúnedain, and of course we know his particular interest in the hobbits, seeing as how his wisdom tells him that they will be major players in Sauron's defeat. Gondor is less interesting to him, and way more interesting to Saruman as a seat of knowledge and power. Gandalf can't guide their proud rulers to anything, and it's only when they gather their courage in the face of their decaying power and what seems to be a losing cause that he shows more concern for them. The name Gandalf is actually a real Norse name, taken from the Poetic Edda, a collection of Old Norse poems. In the context of Tolkien's writings, the name Gandalf most likely represents a Western name, Western being the common mannish tongue of the North. So basically, whenever anyone talks in The Hobbit or The Lord of the Rings, and it looks like they're speaking English, English is simply used to represent Western. But if Tolkien wrote every dialogue in The Hobbit and The Lord of the Rings in Western, it would look like a completely foreign language to you and me. Like, you may as well be reading Klingon. And this goes for names, too. So, like, for example, Bilbo and Frodo are just like the English representations of their actual Western names. If you were to jump down into the Lord of the Rings book and hear people talk, like they actually talk, then people would be saying Bilba Labingi and Maura Labingi, who come from Suzat, rather than Bilbo Baggins and Frodo Baggins, who come from the Shire. This isn't a note in the Unfinished Tales, by the way, I just thought it was worth mentioning. This Western information that I've just talked about can be found in Appendix F of The Lord of the Rings, and the book The Peoples of Middle-earth, which is the 12th and final book in the series, The History of Middle-earth. The Hobbit's true names are listed in the chapter titled The Appendix on Languages, just in case you wanted to look up more stuff about that. And finally, something that has nothing to do with wizards, but it's still mentioned in footnote number 7, The Strange Narrative of Queen Beruthiel. She is the nefarious, solitary, and loveless wife of Taranon, 12th king of Gondor. She hates the sounds and smells of the sea and refuses to live in the house that the king builds on the coast south of Pelargir. Instead, she lives in their house in Osgiliath. She doesn't like colors or adornment, instead wearing only black and silver and keeping the inside of her house almost bare. She does, however, decorate her gardens with creepy, tormented sculptures, and she has 10 cats, 9 black and 1 white. She forces the black ones to spy on the people of Gondor, and she forces the white one to spy on the other ones. Anytime someone sees one of her cats in the street, they stay away from them, because everyone is afraid of what they're gonna go tell her. They're very creepy. And even though her name is erased from the Book of Kings, her infamous memory lives on in Gondor. King Taranon eventually puts her and her cats on a ship and sends them away south. The ship was last seen flying past Umbar under a sickle moon, with a cat at the masthead and another as a figurehead on the prow.